Hi everybody. In the next few videos, we'll be talking about the Schrodinger equation and the rules that govern quantum mechanics. First, I just want to remind us where we left off last time. In the past couple of videos, we said that both light and matter have both wave-like and particle-like characteristics. So what that means is that Newtonian mechanics, which for a couple hundred years had been thought to be entirely correct, actually is incomplete. And a radically different view is needed. And as we said at the end of the last video, it was Erwin Schrödinger who was most responsible for developing this new view, for developing quantum mechanics. Schrödinger developed the equation that's now called the Schrödinger equation, and showed that that equation can predict the energy levels of a hydrogen atom. So this was the first major success of quantum mechanics. We'll be spending most of the course solving the Schrödinger equation in various forms. But first, I want to just introduce us to it. In its most abstract form, the Schrodinger equation actually looks really simple. H psi, that's the Greek letter psi, equals E psi. And the first time you look at this equation, you might think, well, the psi's cancel out, so it's just H equals E. But when we think about what each of these symbols stands for, it's not quite so simple. The letter H represents the Hamiltonian operator. An operator is basically a machine, a series of operations that acts on a function. So in principle, an operator can tell you to multiply or divide or add or subtract a function by certain numbers. It can have derivatives in it. It's any series of operations. And soon we'll talk about what terms are actually in this Hamiltonian operator. The capital E is just a number. It's the energy that you would measure if you took an energy measurement on an object. And this symbol psi really gets at the heart of quantum mechanics. Psi represents what's called the wave function. In classical mechanics, we know that we can represent where an object is and where it's going just by a few x, y, and z coordinates. But as we've said, in quantum mechanics, objects are actually wave-like. So in order to represent where an object is and how fast it's moving, we need to provide information at every point in space. And that's what this wave function does. A wave function is a function that has a value at all points in space that contains all of the information about a particle's position and momentum. If you've taken linear algebra, you may recognize this type of equation, operator applied to a function equals constant times the same function, as what's called an eigenvalue equation. The Schrodinger equation, and actually all equations that apply to taking measurements in quantum mechanics, is an eigenvalue equation. If that term isn't familiar to you, don't worry about it. We'll get there soon. When the Hamiltonian operator is written out, the Schrodinger equation looks more complicated. For a particle that exists in one dimension, the x dimension, the Schrodinger equation looks like this. Negative h bar squared over 2m times the second derivative of the wave function, plus some function v of x that we haven't specified yet times the wave function. Equals E, the measured energy, times the wave function. There are a couple of things I want to point out about this equation. First of all, h bar is a symbol that you haven't seen yet. What it stands for is h, Planck's constant, over 2 pi. We see this grouping of terms so often in quantum mechanics that we give it this new name, h bar. I also want to mention that the Hamiltonian operator really is split into two terms. The first term, negative h bar squared over 2m times the second derivative, represents the kinetic energy of the object, and the second term, V of x, represents the potential energy and depends on what sort of chemical environment the object exists in. Because this equation has derivatives in it, in other words, because it's a differential equation, it's difficult to solve. There are entire courses devoted to solving differential equations, and it's not expected that you've taken those courses. Over the course of this course, we'll learn some tricks to solving simple differential equations, but the reality is that the Schrodinger equation is often difficult or even impossible to solve. We're really not in a position to derive the Schrodinger equation, but since we'll be using the Schrodinger equation so much throughout the course, I want to at least do a little bit to motivate where the Schrodinger equation came from, specifically where this kinetic energy operator, which seems kind of random, came from. So on the next slide, I want to demonstrate that this kinetic energy operator was designed to be consistent with the de Broglie relation. I'll admit that this demonstration is a bit sketchy and it makes a lot of assumptions and skips a lot of steps, but try to bear with me. Suppose we're looking at an object that's represented by a periodic wave function, and by that I mean a sine or a cosine function. So we're going to assume that psi of x is equal to cosine of some constant k times x. We're also assuming that we're in the absence of external forces. In other words, the potential energy operator V of x equals zero. Let's think about what the wavelength of this wave function would be. We know that a cosine function repeats itself every 2 pi, so we're looking for the value of x that causes kx to increase by 2 pi. That's going to be lambda, our wavelength, equals 2 pi over k. De Broglie used the following idea, that the momentum of a wave is equal to Planck's constant h over the wavelength, lambda. So combining these two ideas, the momentum of our wave function, psi of x, is equal to hk over 2 pi, or the way we've defined h bar, it's equal to h bar times k. You may remember from classical physics that kinetic energy is equal to momentum squared over 2 times mass. If we put all of this together, that means that for our object, the de Broglie relation tells us that the kinetic energy equals h bar squared k squared over 2m. Let's put a pin in that and we'll see if the Schrodinger equation agrees with this. In general, the Schrodinger equation in one dimension looks like this. We're interested in the case where psi of x equals cosine kx and v of x equals zero. In that case, the Schrodinger equation becomes this. Hopefully we remember that the second derivative of cosine kx is negative k squared cosine kx, in which case our equation simplifies further, and if we compare the two sides of that equation, we can see that h bar squared k squared over 2m equals E. Because our potential energy operator was zero in this case, we know that all of that energy is kinetic energy. So the Schrodinger equation tells us that the kinetic energy of this wave function is h bar squared k squared over 2m, the same as it was from the de Broglie relation on the previous slide. I should emphasize that we certainly haven't derived the Schrodinger equation. Really, the only reason that the Schrodinger equation was accepted was that it was successful in predicting the energy levels of a hydrogen atom. But because we'll be using the Schrodinger equation so much in this course, I wanted to at least show that the results from the Schrodinger equation are consistent with other physics that was known at the time. So far, we've only seen the Schrodinger equation in one dimension, and I wanted to at least briefly introduce the forms of the Schrodinger equation in two and three dimensions. It looks very similar. The only differences are, first of all, that the potential energy operator V of x becomes a function in more than one variable, V of x and y, or V of x, y, and z. Also, the term that was previously a second derivative with respect to x becomes a sum of second derivatives with respect to all of the spatial variables. And when you're in three dimensions, this term that's the sum of the second derivatives with respect to x, y, and z gets a special symbol and a special name. It's called the Laplacian operator and symbolized by this upside-down triangle squared. We'll see plenty more of this equation soon, and you'll have a lot of chances to practice using it. For the last few minutes of this video, I just want to remind us of, or introduce us to, a couple of points of math. In this course, we'll mostly be dealing with real numbers, but there are a few cases when we'll have to deal with complex numbers. You've probably seen complex numbers at some point in a math course, and we really don't need to know that much about them, but I just want to remind us of a few things. First off, lowercase I is defined as the square root of negative 1. The square roots of positive numbers are real, but the square roots of negative numbers are imaginary. A complex number has both real and imaginary parts. So in general, a complex number z is defined as x plus iy, where x and y are both real, so x is a real part and iy is an imaginary part. The complex conjugate of x plus iy is by definition x minus iy. And if our complex number is called z, then the complex conjugate is often symbolized by z star. An important thing to know about complex conjugates is that a number times its complex conjugate turns out to be real. We can see this by multiplying x minus iy by x plus iy. If you multiply out all of those terms, you get x squared minus I squared y squared. And if we remember that I is the square root of negative 1, this becomes x squared plus y squared, which is real. The other thing that I want to mention is that there's another commonly used form of complex numbers, and that's to express them as complex exponentials, for example, e to the I phi. Euler's formula tells us, and this can be proven with Taylor series, but we won't do it, that a complex number e to the I phi is equal to cosine phi plus I sine phi. And it's possible to show that in this form, the complex conjugate of e to the I phi turns out to be equal to e to the negative I phi. As I said, we won't see complex numbers much in this course, but when we do see them, pretty much everything you need to know is on this slide. I'd also like to talk a little bit about how to interpret the wave function. As we've said, objects in quantum mechanics can't be expressed as simple particles. They're wave-like and can only be described in terms of a wave function, psi. According to the Born interpretation of quantum mechanics, which is the traditional interpretation, at any point, the probability of finding an object is proportional to the wave function times its complex conjugate. Or, since the wave functions that we'll be dealing with are usually real, probability is proportional to the wave function squared. So let's see what that looks like visually. Here's an example of a wave function shown in blue, and the square of that wave function shown in pink. You can see that the wave function has both positive and negative values. It's positive on the left, it crosses through zero in the middle, and it becomes negative on the right. If probability is proportional to the wave function squared, then that means there's some probability of finding this object on the left, some probability of finding this object on the right, but no chance of finding this object at the point where the wave function crosses through zero. This point is called the node, and it's really interesting. We're saying that the object can be on the right, it can be on the left, but it can't be at this point in the middle. Classically, that seems strange, and leaves us wondering how the object would get from one side to the other. But in quantum mechanics, it really doesn't even make sense to think like that. The object is wave-like, so it can have character in different regions of space. That's just how things work in quantum mechanics. And finally, I just want to mention one more mathematical convention in quantum mechanics, and that's the idea of normalization. The Hamiltonian operator, and actually any operator in quantum mechanics, is linear, meaning that if psi is a solution to the Schrodinger equation, then so is any multiple of psi, so is any n psi. Our convention in quantum mechanics is going to be to set that constant such that the probability of finding an object somewhere in space is 1. This makes sense. Even if we don't know exactly where the object is, we would hope that the probability of finding it anywhere in space would add up to 100%. So if we were to take some normalized wave function and plot its square, the area under the curve in the region of space that we care about should be equal to 1. In other words, if we look everywhere in space, we're definitely going to find this object somewhere. Mathematically, the normalization condition looks like this. The integral of the square of a normalized wave function over all space equals 1. So that's all for now. We've introduced ourselves to the Schrodinger equation and some mathematical basics of quantum mechanics. Next time, we'll really get into how quantum mechanics works.